everybody for coming, and welcome to Chapman Construction. We take great pride in offering our education series to you guys, and after a brief hiatus to expand our office and do some of this work here, we've returned to our regular programming with this exciting opportunity, Acoustics 101 with Ben Markham. Brief history for Chapman. For more than 30 years, Chapman has offered construction management services with a focus on sustainability, specializing in interior and ground-up projects for corporate, healthcare, education, and institutional clients. We offer also offer consulting services for building performance, pre-purchase assessments, LEED certification, and renewable energy. No further delay, I'd like to introduce Ben Markham, who is the Director of Architectural Acoustic Services at Acentech. For the past 15 years, Ben has been a principal consultant at Acentech with an extensive portfolio of projects, including the Boston Symphony Orchestra, Museum of Fine Arts, and the United States Institute for Peace. A graduate of Princeton, Ben is an architectural acoustics lecturer at MIT, Cornell, and the Harvard Graduate School of Design. Welcome, Ben.
Thanks. Awesome. Thanks, everybody, for being here. Really appreciate it. Hope you enjoy it. As Guy mentioned, it is an AIA talk. Those that are standing in the back, don't be shy about grabbing a seat if you want. Those that are not, or you know, anybody, don't be shy, period. I would love for this to be as much of a conversation as you want it to be. So interrupt me anytime. Happy to have it be a casual conversation. Guy mentioned this is an AIA talk, and so this starts with the usual AIA thing, which is the course description. Okay, we're going to talk about acoustics. I'm not going to read it to you. We have some learning objectives. There are a number of basics that we're going to cover today, and we are going to use this room as a little bit of a case study for illustrating some of those concepts, addressing things like background sound control from mechanical systems, sound isolation between rooms, and the acoustics of rooms themselves. Just a quick curiosity just to get a sense of the crowd. So if you are an architect, raise your hand. Great. If you are an engineer, a couple of those. If you are an owner's project manager or a representative, a whole bunch of you, awesome. If you are a builder, contractor type, a bunch of those. And who have I not included? Interior design. Excellent. Interior designers. Thank you. Fantastic. All right. Great. So I am an acoustics consultant. As he mentioned, I work for Acentech. We are a company of 60 or so people working in acoustics in AV and IT design and security and in noise and vibration control. And we work on a whole scattering of projects, everything from office work and commercial work, healthcare work, performing arts facilities, worship spaces, residential construction, corporate commercial, wide range of services and project types. It is an AIA talk, and that's me. We are going to start with a little bit of a basics on sound, on introduction to acoustics concepts, and then move fairly quickly into buildings, how that sound behaves in the actual built environment. Come on in, grab a seat, don't be shy. You might say that acoustics in buildings could be thought of in terms of four categories. So we've got room acoustics, the acoustics of rooms themselves, how a room sounds, how clear speech is, or how beautiful the music is. Sound isolation, how much sound the folks are in that conference room hear when I'm gabbing away in this space here. So isolation between spaces or from the exterior, things like that. Background noise, how noisy is the mechanical system from HVAC systems, things like that. And then amplification, loudspeaker systems that are used to amplify a signal. And these concepts apply to all kinds of spaces, right? Office spaces, classroom spaces, conference rooms, and so forth. And we can take these four concepts and kind of reorganize them a little bit. We can shuffle the deck and reorganize them in terms of something called signal-to-noise ratio. And signal-to-noise ratio is... Welcome. No, don't be sorry. Come on in. Grab a seat. So signal-to-noise ratio is a really fundamental and really important and often misunderstood concept in acoustics. And the idea is not unique to acoustics by any means. So let's take another example, just forgetting about acoustics for a second. And let's say, for example, in economics. So if you parked on the street outside in a no parking zone and you get out from this conference and you go to your car and you've got a ticket and it's a $50 ticket. If you are fresh out of school and broke and don't earn a lot of money, $50 is a real hit to your day-to-day life. If you are Bill Gates, $50 does not move the needle, right? Completely doesn't matter. It's the same $50, but it matters a whole lot more if you're broke than it does if you're Bill Gates. Guys in the back, feel free, come in, grab a seat, don't be shy. So it's not so much that $50 is important, that's the signal, okay? But the relationship between that 50 bucks and the background condition of your income, all right? And you can apply this same concept to lots of things in life, right? Like saltiness or pain or, you know, whatever. So, you know, the same is true in acoustics. If you are creating a sound that's very loud, well, if you're in a room that's loud already, it may not matter. But if you're in a room that's very, very quiet, a loud sound is very clearly audible. So the loudness of something in and of itself, that's only half the equation. It's the loudness relative to the background noise that's really meaningful. Well, amplification, that is clearly in the signal category. Amplification's purpose in life is to amplify the signal, make the signal louder, make my voice louder, make the rock stars on stage louder, whatever. And background noise, well, that's obviously on the noise side of things, right? HVAC systems, electrical systems that are humming in the background, that's noise. Sound isolation, that's about controlling noise as well, right? So if during this conference Chapman was throwing a party in their office up there and they were making a lot of noise, that would be bothersome to us. And so the isolation that's provided by that window wall would be related to the noise side of this signal-to-noise equation. And then room acoustics, it sort of can go either way. You can imagine a room that is really echoey, really reverberant, and that actually gets in the way of the signal. It makes the signal less intelligible. Or you can imagine a room with really supportive acoustics that naturally amplifies the speech, but in a way that isn't detracting from its intelligibility. And in fact, this room, as you will discover over the course of this presentation, went through a change in its initial design, initial build-out. There wasn't any sound-absorbing treatment, and it was too reverberant. And speech in this room was difficult to understand. But thanks to a bit of work on Chapman's part, with an Acentech assist, there is sound-absorbing treatment in the room. We're going to talk about that. And now, speech is just fine in this space. You can hear and understand what it is that I'm saying. All right? So, not just signal, not just noise, but the relationship between the two. Cool? All right. So, with that said, a really quick introduction on the basics and physics of sound. Sound, this is a fancy science-y definition, a vibration through an elastic medium. So, what that means is that what we're talking about is sound is a wave that is hitting, if you will, the molecules that make up air. Those molecules are bouncing back and forth, they're vibrating in place, and air in our case is a medium. Now, if you look at this diagram here, what's on the chart, you can see that if you focus on any individual particle, like this red one in the middle here, it's not moving. When I speak, I'm not sending sound particles throughout the room, right? I'm sending sound waves throughout the room, but the particles, they're basically staying put. They're vibrating in place. But the wave is propagating across the room. And so that movement of the wave's sound from one side to the other is what is propagating that sound. The particles, though, they are bouncing back and forth in place. That's what's meant by elastic. The particles bounce back to where they started. And through a medium, which could be steel or water or air, in our case, mostly air. Okay, make sense? All right, great. So waves in general, and sound waves in particular, have a number of properties: amplitude, frequency, propagation. Let's talk about these kind of one by one. So amplitude can be measured in a number of different ways: sound pressure, sound power. You can think of it in terms of also the displacement. So those particles in that diagram, how far they move or how much pressure they're under, that's amplitude. And amplitude is related to how loud something sounds. And the thing about amplitude is that it exists on a huge scale. So we as humans can hear sound that ranges from 10 to the minus 16 watts per centimeter squared to 10 to the minus 3 watts per centimeter squared. So those that are good at math, that's 13 orders of magnitude. That is a huge range. That's roughly equivalent to the range from the width of a human hair to a 30-story building. That difference in height, that's 13 orders of magnitude in height. Okay? So you could think of sound pressure or sound intensity as existing over that level of a range. And that's really hard to kind of get your head around. And because that's so hard to get your head around, engineers a long time ago developed this idea of a decibel. Everybody's heard of a decibel. It's related to how loud something is. Turns out a decibel is a unitless measure, right? You can have a decibel of anything. You could have a decibel of how hard your homework is if you're a student. You could have a decibel of you know, the saltiness of a meal. It by itself is a unitless figure, and it's a unitless figure because it's based on a ratio. It compresses this 13 orders of magnitude into a manageable scale, like 0 to 130, and it exists on a logarithmic basis. It's a little bit like the Richter scale in that regard. So if you guys are familiar with the Richter scale for earthquakes, 0 to 10, so the difference between a 5 and a 6 is a big deal, and the difference between a 5 and a 7 is an arithmetic, a logarithmically increased difference, right? And the same is true in acoustics. So it's a log scale. So a 10 decibel change, generally speaking, is going to correspond to about a doubling of how loud something is. And a 20 decibel change would be 4 times. And a 30 decibel change would be 8 times. So it increases in a logarithmic fashion. Make sense? All right. So A little bit word on nomenclature, and this may be particularly interesting to mechanical engineers and to OPMs and others that are looking at data that is produced for noise-making things in buildings, cooling towers or generators or widgets or whatever. If you're talking about a decibel, it's going to be either in sound pressure level or sound power level. Sound power is measured in watts. Sound power level is measured in decibels. Sound pressure is in pascals or pounds per square inch, but sound pressure level is in decibels. So pressure and power are both in decibels, and that's annoying and confusing, and so let me just break that down a little bit. If you've got a light, and you have a light bulb, let's say it's an old-fashioned energy-sucking 100-watt halogen light bulb, and that 100-watt light bulb you put into a room that is painted white. And then you go and you take a light meter and you measure the lux, you measure the foot candles in that room. And then you take that same 100-watt light bulb and you put it into a room painted black. You take your same light meter. Which room is going to measure more foot candles? The white room, of course. Why? Because the walls are reflective, right? Same is true in sound. If you have a widget that produces 65 decibels of sound power, take the same widget and you put it into, in one case, a bathroom with hard tile surfaces, and then you take it and you move it into a sound recording studio that is everywhere fuzzy, it's going to be louder in the bathroom. Sound pressure level is greater in the bathroom. Sound pressure level is less in the recording studio. But the sound power level produced by the widget is the same in either place. Well, in light, we know really obvious, right? We measure power in watts. We measure the brightness of that in say, foot candles or lux or other, and so forth. In sound, unfortunately, You can measure everything in decibels, and so we do both in decibels. So be careful if you're reading a cut sheet of a cooling tower that you know whether you're talking about power or pressure, or find someone who does. All right, so that's amplitude. This is frequency, another property of sound. Sound can go from low to high. A high frequency sound means that that wavefront, that remember that image on the screen of that wave moving across the screen, a high frequency sound means that a bunch of waves go by in a second. A low frequency sound means only a few waves go by in a second. So if you've got the same second, you've got only a few waves going by, that's going to be a low frequency sound. And frequency corresponds with pitch. So what we hear is pitch. In amplitude's case, what we hear is loudness. In frequency's case, what we hear is pitch. So a low rumble, machine, that's going to have a low frequency. A hiss, that's a high frequency sound. All right, and frequency is measured in hertz or cycles per second. And when we look at the two together, almost every graph you'll see in the world of acoustics, you've got frequency on the horizontal and amplitude on the vertical. So we've got low frequency sound, rumbles off to the left here, and high frequency sound, hisses off to the right, and really quiet at the bottom and really loud at the top. And up at the top, there's a magenta line there, the threshold of pain. And somewhere north of that is the threshold of I'm dead. So you know what, you gotta stay south of that, right? And so somewhere up around 120 or so decibels. Just below threshold of pain is the threshold of sensation. So if you, any of you guys go to rock clubs and you're at a show and you can feel just a little bit like this sort of tingling in your ears, that is a good sign that your hearing mechanism is telling you you are entering a dangerous territory. All right, watch it. The bottom is green. This green line at the bottom is the threshold of audibility, threshold of perception. And that threshold, you will notice, is not a flat line. At 1,000 hertz, at 2,000 hertz, we can hear at 0 decibels. In fact, in the right environment, less than 0 decibels at 2,000 hertz, if your hearing is good and so forth. However, at 50 hertz, down at the low end, you've got to create about 60 decibels of sound before it's even audible, before you can even detect it. All right? So we don't hear equally at every frequency. Some other observations you can make about this, this little chart here. The middle, there's this bean-shaped blob. That bean-shaped blob represents the range of human speech. So vowel sounds are at the top. Top means loud, right? So in the vowel sounds, that's what carries the power of my voice. If I want to get louder, the vowels get louder. And if I want to get quieter, the vowels get quieter. The consonants are about the same level, and they're higher in frequency. They're up in the high frequency range, and it's if the vowels carry the power, it's the consonants that carry the message. The consonants are what carry the actual words, the articulation of what I'm saying. The voiced consonants are under the vowels. They are in the same frequency range as the vowels, but they're lower in level. And that's because when we say them, our mouths close. So I've got three little kids at home, and they say, mama, mama. And if you say, mama, mama, you have an ah, and then you close your mouth and you make a mm. And so mama, mama is at the same frequency, but mm is quieter than ah. Get it? All right, so that's the range of human speech, 60-ish decibels, middle frequency range. And isn't it interesting, thanks to evolution or creation or whatever you believe in, that speech is created in the exact same frequency range to which we are most sensitive to it, right? So we can communicate. Our hearing mechanism is most sensitive at the very frequencies at which we speak. So we can talk. We can hear each other. Handy. Another observation that you might make about this, this is normal hearing. This big yellow blob here represents hearing of a teenager who hasn't listened to too much music via earbuds. But as soon as you get a little older, your hearing starts falling off. It does so on a continuous basis as you age, and it generally, for most people, falls off starting at the right and moving to the left. You lose the high frequencies first. So, how many of you know somebody who is losing their hearing or has lost their hearing? And how many of you have had a conversation with somebody Who has? Yeah. And how many of you have had this kind of conversation where you speak to said individual, let's say it's grandma or grandpa, and you sensitively broach the subject of maybe not hearing quite as well, and the response is resistive. What do you mean? I can hear just fine. I can hear everything. Does that sound familiar? All right. So it turns out you're both right. If you're losing your hearing starting at the high frequencies, if grandma's losing her hearing starting at the high frequencies, that means she's missing the consonants. And remember, it's the consonants that carry the message, the t, p, ts. So if grandma's losing her hearing and she's losing the p, ts, she can't understand what's being said. But she hasn't lost this. That's in a lower frequency range. She can hear the vowel sounds just fine. In fact, she can hear them just as loud as you do. So when she says she can hear you just fine, you don't have to scream. It's true. You don't have to scream because she can hear those sounds, the ones that carry the power of your voice, just fine. It's just she can't understand what you're saying. It sounds like mumble because she's missing the ts, t, that's that you're hearing, all right? So you're right, she needs a hearing aid, and she's right, she can also hear you just fine. All right. So the first thing that we do when we're engaged in a project is that we go about, remember that signal to noise ratio, we go about setting background sound level goals. So you remember that last graph where I said that frequency was on the horizontal and loudness was on the vertical or amplitude? That's still true here. This little graph here, we've got frequency on the horizontal, we've got sound pressure level in decibels on the vertical, and superimposed on that graph are a series of black lines that were standardized back in the 50s. They're called noise criteria lines, or NC lines. And this is the way in the United States that we set background sound goals for rooms. So if we're working with an architect on a project, or an owner on a project, and that project has different rooms in it, maybe it's a school, and you've got classrooms, and you've got lobby spaces, and you've got an auditorium, and you've got these, or it's an office space, you've got a conference room, but you've also got open plan offices. You've got different kinds of spaces, different kinds of uses. First thing we'll do is we'll set some criteria. How loud is it okay for those rooms to be? If you're working with a world-class concert hall, you don't want to hear any background sound at all. Threshold of hearing. But if you're working with maybe a high school auditorium, be a little, you don't want it to be loud, but you want to set a criteria that's reasonable and appropriate. But not a professional concert hall, okay. Boardroom, classroom. If it's a lobby space, let's not freak out. You know, it can be louder. We can tolerate more noise level in a lobby space. In an office environment, and we'll talk about this right at the end, you might actually want a bit of background sound to help mask or cover over annoying speech. Remember, signal to noise. Remember, signal to noise is about maximizing the signal and minimizing the noise when you want to hear the signal. But in an office environment, if you're in an open plan, you don't want to hear your office mate on the phone. You don't want to hear that. It's annoying. It's distracting. And so you want to reverse the signal to noise ratio. And how do you do that? Well, you can introduce a little bit of background sound. And if you do that in a controlled manner, then a little bit of background sound is actually quite welcome in that environment. And there's a technology called sound masking that can be utilized to that advantage. Make sense? All right. So in this room, when the air handler on the roof is off, it's way down here. It's this purple line that you can see just here. It's very quiet. It's NC22 in this space. When it kicks on, before a few little upgrades, it was pretty loud. It was up around NC50, NC40-ish in the mid-frequency range. Once we made a few upgrades in recent days, we got 10 NC points. We made a substantial improvement in the background sound. Remember, a 10-point change, that corresponds to a doubling or a cutting in half of the sound level. So with some fairly modest upgrades, we were able to cut that sound level in half, and in particular, in the speech frequency range, cut it down to under NC35 when the air handling unit cuts on. You'll hear it when it does. Okay? Of course, people screw this up all the time. This is a field house at a high school here on the Eastern Seaboard. I won't name names. And it was NC70 when we showed up. That is bad news. That is really bad. And so we thought, all right, well, maybe if we just turn down the capacity of the air handler, it would fix the problem. But at 60% load, it was only NC60. It didn't buy us all that much. That's still way too loud to be able to talk. So it is possible to screw this up, and it can be quite problematic. In this case, it was a unit right inside the room, no attenuation, no lining, problematic. So, all right, we've talked about amplitude, we've talked about frequency. Let's talk a little bit about the speed of sound. Speed and frequency, point number one, are not the same. So, by way of illustration, let's imagine for a second that I'm a little bit more fashionable than I am, and I own one of those little fashionable small dogs. You know what I'm talking about? Like, you see people who like walk around the south end of Boston with their small dog, right? And they have, and they're very fashionable, and they walk their dog. Okay, so picture me and my fashionable small dog walking around, and I'm walking my dog, and the dog is walking too. And I have my normal size steps, and I'm walking at my normal size pace, and the dog is keeping up. Me and the dog, we're walking at the same speed. The dog and I are walking at the same speed. But my legs are moving at my normal gait. The dog's legs, however, in order to keep up with the same speed, are going, right? Got that in your head? So the frequency of my steps is low. The frequency of the dog's steps are very high, but me and the dog, we are walking at the same speed. Frequency and speed, not the same. And I'll draw the analogy one step further. The length of my gait, how far I step, is long. With my low frequency, I have a long gait. The dog, by contrast, it's got a very short gait. Its steps are small. The analogy to sound is called wavelength. A low frequency has a long wavelength, and a high frequency has a short wavelength. All right, and those things are related to each other by this fancy formula. C, the speed of sound, is equal to F, frequency, times lambda, wavelength. You don't really need to know that, but that's how it's all related. And it matters because wavelength exists at architectural scale. See, in air, C is always the same. In air, the speed of sound never changes, roughly. Indoors, it never changes. Outdoors, it changes a little. And so that means that if frequency ranges from, say, 20 hertz to 20,000 hertz, what we hear, then wavelength is going to range from about 60 feet to half an inch or so. Architecture ranges from 60 feet to half an inch or so. See, the thing about light is that you can always be sure that the wavelength of light is really, really tiny with respect or in comparison to the size of the dimensions of the stuff in rooms, right? But the fundamental difference between light waves and sound waves in terms of our thinking about how they interact with buildings is that buildings are the same size as the wavelengths of sound that hit them. And that implies some fairly interesting things. If a wavelength of sound encounters a wall, and that wall is big with respect to wavelength, then it bounces off of that surface the way that a billiard ball bounces off the rail of a pool table, which is to say the angle of incidence equals the angle of reflection. All right? And it bounces just the way you would expect it. But if the element in the room is small, then the wave doesn't even see it. Imagine, for example, that we've taken a big rock and we've dropped it into an ocean of water. And we drop that big rock into the ocean of water and you see the ripples of the waves go by. And we take an object like this, something small, like a pen, and we put that thing into the water. The wave goes by, it doesn't even see this. The wave just goes right by it. The technical term is that it diffracts around that object. So if we had a column in the middle of this room, the sound of my voice is just going to wrap right around that column. If you were on the other side of the column, you'd be annoyed. You couldn't see me very well, but you'd be able to hear me just fine. The sound would go right around the column and keep going. All right? So when the object is small, sound doesn't matter. Doesn't care about that object. It goes right around it. When the object is big, like that big wall, two-story wall there, sound bounces off in highly predictable ways. But what happens, do you suppose, when the size of the wavelength is about the same as the size of the object it encounters? If the object is big, it bounces off. If the object is small, it goes around it. What happens when the size of my voice let's say at about 2 feet, characteristic dimension of my wavelength, hits this chair, which is about 2 feet in its characteristic dimension. Any guesses? It scatters. In highly unpredictable ways, that sound starts bouncing all over the place. And that, it turns out, is incredibly useful if you are designing spaces where the uniformity of sound is important. You're designing a concert hall, for example, and you'd like all the seats to be good, then you want to have lots of stuff in that room to break up that sound and scatter it all over the place. So one of the reasons that modern, with a capital M, style concert halls are not generally very well-regarded acoustically. Mies van der Rohe didn't design any well-regarded concert halls because that aesthetic, which relies on such clean lines, is antithetical to this idea of scattering that energy around. You would end up with harsh kind of hot spots in an auditorium rather than a more uniform sound field. Same principle applies to recording studios and other rooms where this stuff matters. Okay? Questions about that? All right. So, talk about amplitude, frequency, speed, propagation. So, most sources, you can think of the sound of a thing, say my hands, as emanating from a single point and emanating out like a sphere. And point and sources that are like that, they drop off by 6 decibels per doubling of distance. So every time you get twice as far away, 6 dB down. So at the beginning, you make a lot of headway, right? The first 2 feet, when you go from 2 feet to 4 feet, you've cut 6 dB down. 4 feet to 8 feet, another 6 dB. 8 feet to 16 feet, another 6 dB. But to get to the next 6 dB after that, you've got to go 32 feet, and then 64 feet, and then 128 feet away, right? So 6 dB per doubling of distance. That's for a point source, but not everything is a point source. The most common example of a line source in our environment is a highway. A line source, only 3 dB per doubling of distance. See, a point emanates like a sphere, and the surface area of a sphere goes like R cubed. But the surface area of a cylinder, if you imagine a line source emanates not like a sphere, but like a cylinder. And the surface area of, surface area of a sphere goes like R squared, and the surface area of a cylinder goes like R, not like R squared, which means you only get 3 decibels of doubling per distance. So you move 10 feet away from a highway, from 10 to 20 feet, you get 3 dB, not 6. 20 to 40 feet, 3 dB, not 6. 40 to 80 feet, 3 dB, not 6. So which is the more insidious noise source for urban planning? Is it the power plant or the highway? The highway. The highway is the problem because that noise source bugs everybody in the whole suburban community. Whereas the power plant is only going to bug those people that are closest to it. Make sense? All right. That's true outside. Inside, turns out, it's a different ball of wax. We'll get to that in a second. Finally, some diffraction wave behavior. If you've got sound, it's hitting, say, an open door in a wall, it starts bending. If sound was a ray, it wouldn't do this. But sound isn't a ray, it's a wave, and so it diffracts in that kind of a condition. That's why if I, you know, hide behind a barrier, people can still hear me. Okay, so we have talked a bit about some of the basics of sound. Let's dive into those components we talked about: background noise, room acoustics, and sound isolation. So background sound, quick. 3 main components that are driving noise in buildings. There's airflow velocities through ducts, fan noise, the noise of fans, and vibrating equipment. All right? So what do you suppose we're going to do about these one at a time? Airflow velocities, high airflow velocity, turbulence in the air. What's the noise control solution to that problem? Lower the velocity, that's right. And how do we lower the velocity? Great big ducts. Yeah, just what you were doing, big ducts. Designers, it almost never fails to amaze designers and OPMs and so forth, how big the ducts are in performing arts spaces. They are just so ginormous. You can drive a bus through these ducts because the air has to move so so slowly. Fan noise. So what's the solution to fan noise? Pick a quiet fan, actually. That's the best solution to fan noise. How many of you, by any chance, are into cars? Anybody into cars here? A couple of people. How many of you have ever been in a car? The rest of you? Yeah. Right, so those of you that have been in a car, if you were driving down the road and the car in front of you has that tailpipe, and that tailpipe is connected to a thing called a muffler, that's right, and a muffler's job is to muffle, yes, reduce sound, exactly. And so fan noise is the same way. We can stick a muffler, a sound attenuator, we call it, into a duct. It works basically on the same technology, and reduce the noise of that fan. However, if you're into cars, who was into cars that was there? All right, so one of the first things that you might do if you're into cars and you want more performance out of your car is to get rid of the muffler, right? Why? The back pressure, exactly. So, or because loud cars are sexy, that I get that sometimes too, which might be true, I don't know. So what does that mean, back pressure? So if you've got a muffler in the flow of the exhaust, right? You rev your engine, you're trying to go, but the engine has to work against the pressure of that muffler in order to just, you know, for that exhaust to get out the tailpipe. There is pressure that that muffler exerts back onto the engine that it has to work against. You take that out of the way, and the energy that the engine is using can all go to propelling the car forward instead of having to work against that back pressure that the muffler inserts on the car. The same is true of mechanical systems. And Chapman, I know, is highly devoted to energy efficiency and sustainability. And this is one of these cool things where the world of sustainability and the world of acoustics are very hand in hand. Because if you select a fan that is energy inefficient, it will be noisier. And if it's noisier, you are going to insert a muffler, a sound attenuator. But that sound attenuator is going to exert back pressure on that fan, which makes the fan have to work harder, which means it's going to be even noisier and draw more energy in order to heat and cool that building. But if you select the more energy efficient fan to begin with, it won't generate as much noise, which means you might not need that muffler, which means it won't exert back pressure on the fan, which means it will not use up as much energy. With me? All right, so that's fan noise. Quiet machines, first and foremost, or mufflers, sound attenuators. Last one, vibrating equipment, maybe the most important at all. How many of you have a cell phone? Everybody has a cell phone. How many of you keep your cell phone on vibrate? Okay, 2/3 of the room. Those of you that keep your cell phone on vibrate, when it vibrates, you can still hear it, right? Is it louder when it is in your hand or when it's on a table? On the table, why? Hard surface, that's right, what? Has something to vibrate against, that's right. That table is a sounding board. You have this vibrating thing connected to a table. That energy is in the table, and that thing it's vibrating against re-radiates all that energy, right? If I pluck a string in midair, not that loud, but if I connect that string to a sounding board, I have a piano, really loud, right? Imagine what you can do then, if you take a vibrating thingamajig and you bolt it to a roof. Can you imagine a bigger sounding board than a roof? So if we have a vibrating thingamajig, job one is to do what? Isolate that vibration with a vibration isolator. That's exactly it. Everybody on board? Let's keep going. So you have a rooftop piece of mechanical equipment. We've got all these paths to chase down. We've got to chase down air through the supply duct, through the breaking out of the duct itself, through the roof deck, or through those vibration connections, or through the return duct. All right, we've got to catch them all. And if we want really, really quiet, this is Bass Hall in Fort Worth, you might take that mechanical equipment and put it in a different zip code. You can do that in Texas. They're big and big down there. Texas, you've got the mechanical equipment of Bass Hall in Fort Worth under the street or in the adjacent building. It's not even in the same structure as the concert hall, all right? And we're going to have that equipment really go through some work. On supply side, it goes through these vaults and then through these vaults into a huge plenum and then through a whole bunch of tiny little holes under the seats in that auditorium at very, very low velocity to cool that space. It's a displacement air system. On the return side, that air goes up through these holes where the lights are and through some great big ducts to get up to energy recovery units. So that the air is moving very, very slowly and the equipment is nowhere nearby. All right. Now, that's an expensive project and has a big budget and all of that, but these goals of low noise, they can be accomplished on reasonable budgets as well, as long as you keep the basic principles in mind and you do the planning in advance. Vibration can happen in other ways, too. This is Benaroya Hall in Seattle. There's a railroad tunnel under the auditorium, and so between this auditorium and that railroad, there is base building isolation. That structure is on a great big laminated rubber pad. All right? Sometimes we put rooms on springs. This is the Experimental Music Performing Arts Center in Troy, New York, MPAC, at the campus of Rensselaer Polytech. That's a concert hall in there. Grimshaw designed it. This is a studio next door, Studio One at MPAC. And Studio One is sitting on these. And these springs get laid out in these little gray thingamajigs onto a slab. So you've got a slab. You put a piece of plastic down, you put these springs in place, put your rebar in place, you pour a second slab on the plastic after the first slab is cured, and then one gray thingamajig at a time, you go around to these springs and you crank them up a quarter of a turn at a time and literally jack up slab number one off of slab number two. So at the end of the day, you've got a 4-inch slab on 2 inches of isolation springs, airspace, isolated airspace, and then your structural slab below that. So what does that mean? You can make as much noise as you want to in Studio One, and the folks in the concert hall will never hear it. Because that, although that energy is getting into the floor and vibrating that floor, it will not transfer via the floor into the adjacent space. Cool, huh? All right. You can screw that up too, though. Here is a vibrating thingamajig, and it's on vibration isolation, and then there is some rigid conduit that is tying that thing back down to the roof, right? So we do have to watch out for ways in which these systems are short-circuited and make sure that we do not compromise the integrity of that vibration isolation. Planning gets important too. This is a chiller plant at an institute of higher learning here on the Eastern Seaboard, and it's right outside of a dorm room. It is mega loud. The folks in that dorm room had a hard time sleeping when that was installed, but you know, it was installed. A lot of pipes go to this thing, a lot of infrastructure involved in putting something like that in place. I'm sure you'll all agree that the fix on this problem was particularly architecturally sensitive. It looks like this. The view from the second floor windows of that dorm room are particularly prime. No, actually nobody thought this was a good idea, except for the folks that sold them the mufflers on top of that guy thought this was a great idea. We're looking at a barrier, this giant exhaust muffler, and all of that was done at no small cost because this was a really, really dumb place to put a chiller plant, right? So don't do that. Other examples, here's a yellow thingamajig. It makes a lot of noise. It's on a roof, and there are some neighbors over in that direction. We thought, all right, let's build a really strong barrier, a concrete wall, right? Fine. And let's put that barrier really close to the thingamajig. Also fine. But remember, there are airflow requirements for most of these things. And if you put the barrier really close to the thingamajig, it may not be able to operate correctly. And in fact, that was the case here. And so in order to allow it to operate correctly, the solution to the problem was, yeah. So how effective do you suppose that barrier is now? Not so much. Oy, oy, oy. All right. So sound isolation then, that brings me to the topic of isolating sound from one place to another. And we can think about that in terms of outdoor to outdoor noise, like those yellow thingamajigs or rock concert venues or highways. We can think about it in outdoor to indoor kind of modality where you've got worries about fenestration, right? Curtain walls, things like that. All the buildings that's going on in the seaport these days with Logan Airport nearby, that's a major consideration. But right now, I want to talk to you a little bit about indoor to indoor isolation, like the isolation from this room to that room. So if you're designing, say, high school band room suite, don't do this. It's a really bad idea. Don't put your band room right next to your choir room. Take advantage of smart planning and think about your adjacencies. Take advantage of the fact that you need storage and you need office and you're going to need a corridor for people to walk through so that you don't have to build a really expensive wall between thing one and thing two that you know is already a sensitive space. So rule number one on sound isolation is do your planning in advance and think through what's next to what. Having done that, though, you may still need some walls to do some work. And this is a diagram of a highly conventional, very typical condominium wall in Greater Boston, a double stud wall separating condo one from condo two. We see this all over the place, sort of the standard construction in this market. This is a solid wall. Can you do better? Yeah, you can absolutely do better. But this is a totally decent wall. You've got a number of things that are important about this wall. Three, in fact. Item one, mass. There are four layers of gypsum board on this wall. It's heavy. That's useful acoustically. Item two, separation. Remember that pressure wave with those molecules bumping into each other? Well, there are two walls here. Those molecules start moving wall number one. Well, there's an air gap, and then wall number two is over here. You move this wall doesn't move so much. Make sense? So mass, that's useful, but at a certain point, you run out of mass, or your building is just going to get just wicked heavy and inefficient. So let's beat mass law by saying, all right, let's take that mass and split it into two parts that aren't connected to each other, hence double walls, suspended ceilings, etc. Make sense? Thing one, mass. Thing two, separation. Thing three, insulation inside the wall. Turns out it doesn't do us a lot of good, or really any good, to put the insulation on the outside of the wall when you're talking about isolation from one space to the next. But put the insulation on the inside of the wall, and it boosts performance a great deal. Yeah?
What's the STC on this partition type, and how would you make it better?
Yeah, great questions. STC on this, if I am assuming 3 5/8 studs that are 20 gauge at 16 inches on center, this wall is about an STC 60. Now, I can make it better in small ways by making this wall limp. So this is a weird thing, right? Contractors and others, I think, folks out in the field generally tend to think, for good reason, that stronger is better. But it turns out that stiffer is our enemy in acoustics, because those molecules, when you have a stiff structure, have an easier time bumping into each other. So the ideal in acoustics is massive but limp. So if instead of 16 inches on center, these studs were at 24 inches on center, and instead of 20 gauge, they were 25 gauge, instead of STC 60, this wall is A, cheaper, and B, STC 65. But you can't really build walls with 25 gauge studs 24 inches on center, right? In typical floor-to-floor heights, you're just not going to make that work, right? So what else can you do? Well, you can add more mass, right? You can add more layers of gypsum board. Or you can use a more effective insulation product, although that's on the margins. So in terms of practical things, so adding more mass, for example, you could add more layers of gypsum board, or you could go CMU plus stud wall. That's a very effective wall, very high-end wall. The most high-end walls that you would ever see in a residential setting would be to have a CMU wall fully grouted and have a stud wall on either side. You almost never see that in this market, but they're out there. They exist. Or you could really go nuts. This is a sketch of a floor-ceiling assembly that separates a percussion room from a recital hall at the Berklee College of Music in downtown Boston. It's a renovation. It's newish. The new percussion studios that are in the basement of that building on Boylston Street, is that? Yeah, Boylston and Mass Ave. Not in the Ron Tower, but in the building across Mass Ave from that. So there we have a structural floating isolation slab that's concrete on isolation springs on the structural slab with resilient clips suspending two layers of gypsum board, a giant airspace insulated, and two more layers of gypsum board. There are one, two, three, four mass layers all separated from one another. So you can do all sorts of crazy things. This percussion studio was in that space. They have four layers of gypsum board on them, not two. All right, so even if you build this great wall, then sound might still get around it, right? So the most common problem that we run into is that the wall doesn't go all the way up to the deck, all right? So we call these paths for sound to sort of circumvent or go around the wall, flanking paths, where sound circumvents or flanks that wall that is the issue. If the wall has a couple layers of gypsum board, it's pretty heavy. The ceiling might be pretty lightweight. So if you don't run that wall all the way up, the sound will go right over top of it. Okay? Makes sense? That's path one. Path two, the ducts. Sound could go in the duct. A duct, especially if it's unlined, is a hollow metal speaking tube. Right? Just connecting one room to the next. Or it can break out of the duct. That's path three. Path four, back-to-back outlets. An outlet is a hole in the wall. A back-to-back outlet is a hole in the wall that goes all the way through the wall. Path five, if you've got a double stud, but you do something, put in a gusset plate to build something, bridging one side of the wall to the other, that's a short circuit. Baseboard radiators, that's a hole in your wall. There's lots of things that are holes in your wall. The structure itself, unless you have a floating slab, at some point, sound can flank through the structure. And every room has a door, and the door has gaps around the edges unless it's fully gasketed, and so on and so forth. So part of your job, if you're isolating a room, is to track down not just what the partitions and the floor ceiling assemblies ought to be, but what all of the other paths might be that could potentially weaken that isolation. Okay? So what do you do about the duct thing? They all have ducts, right? Well, if the supply duct goes from room to room to room, office to office to office, hollow metal speaking tube. But if that duct runs in the corridor and it's internally lined, well now sound, if it's gonna go via the duct path, has to go up, then it's gotta turn the corner, then it's gonna go up again. And so it's a much more circuitous path. It's absorbed along the way if it's internally lined, and so now the duct path is no weaker than the wall is. Make sense? Here's a double wall, framed. What's wrong with this picture? Doesn't go all the way to the deck. Bingo. Drywallers go in there, put the drywall up, they stop at the bottom of the trusses, sound goes right over the top of the stud. Double wall is a waste of money, space, all the rest of it. Unless what? How do we fix this problem? Double ceilings. You got two layers of drywall on each side of this wall, you bought yourself two layers of drywall on your ceiling on each side of this wall. Then the ceiling is in balance with the wall. Unless you've got recessed lights that make Swiss cheese out of your ceiling, and so let's solve that problem too. All right? Make sense? All right. Doors are a weak link everywhere. Vestibules are a good answer to that problem. Let's not dwell on that. Time is short. Room acoustics. So we've talked about noise. We've talked about sound isolation. Now let's talk about sound in rooms. This is an image of a model of how sound will propagate, in this particular case, at a synagogue in Omaha. Okay. You can think of sound in rooms kind of tracing its history in the one case to the cave and into the other case to the open air. And from the cave and a big reverberant open environment, from the cave we get the cathedral and from the cathedral the concert hall. From the open air we get the town square, the marketplace, the theater, the lecture hall, the conference center. Right? So there's a lot of daylight between Westminster Abbey and an open-air theater, obviously, a lot of space in between. But you can think of acoustics in general in rooms as being tied to one or the other and draw some distinctions. Outside, 6 dB per doubling of distance. Every time you double your distance away, you get 6 dB. Inside, though, the sound levels off, right? If it's a very reverberant space, sound is bouncing all over the place, and the sound, as you move further and further away, is no quieter. No matter how far you are from the organ in a big cathedral, it's just as loud. But the more fuzz you put into that room, fuzz being a technical term for sound absorption, the more fuzz you put in that room, the more dead that room is, the more it behaves like an outdoor space. The more the sound does drop off with increasing distance. So that's sound versus distance, sound versus time. Outside, you clap your hands, and the sound just stops. Inside, it bounces around. In a cathedral, it lingers. You clap your hands in Westminster Abbey, and you can measure reverberation time with a calendar. Right? It just rings and rings and rings and rings. Right? So in a reverberant space, it takes a long time for that sound to linger. But if you put a lot of absorption in, it becomes a more outdoors-like environment. It drops off more quickly. The more fuzz there is, the drier it is, the deader that room is, The clearer the sound, the more intelligible the speech will be. And we owe a lot of thanks to this guy, this funny little man in this funny little box, is Wallace Clement Sabin, who was a professor at Harvard who developed this formula for reverberation time. And he's figured out that the size of the room divided by how much absorption there is in that room is reverberation time, how long sound decays, takes to decay. All right, and there's a funny story about Wallace Clement Sabin stealing seat cushions from Sanders Theater at Harvard in order to do these measurements. And at our office at Acentech, we have one of only two in the world that exist of the original Sanders Theater seat cushions from Harvard that were used in Wallace Clement Sabin's original reverberation time experiments. If you're curious about the history lesson, stick around afterwards. It, initially it was. No, so SDC is about sound transmission, right? Sound transmission class. But the original, you know, Sanders Theater seat cushion, it's funny you say that, because the original unit of absorption, which is, these days is called the Sabin, named after Wallace Clement Sabin, the original unit of absorption was one Sanders Theater seat cushion. It really was. And people referred to it as SDC, which was confusing because SDC means something different now. So in this room that we're in right now, before any of these wall panels were up and before any of the panels on the ceiling were up, it was a more reverberant space. And we came here at Chapman's invitation and we did some measurements of that reverberation. Instead of clapping our hands, we made this funny noise. My colleague Alicia made these measurements. And from these measurements, we calculated how reverberant this room is at different frequencies. The sound goes boop because we're measuring it at every frequency. And before, believe it or not, this room was way up here at 1.6, 1.7 seconds of reverberation time. And now, if you look up, you can see there are panels on the ceiling over there, and there are panels on the walls over here and over here. And all of that treatment means that now we are at a much more comfortable 7/10 of a second or so. Make sense? So, natatorium, fancy word for a swimming pool. 6 second reverberation time with no treatment, but put some treatment in place, 1.7 seconds. Much better. All right? So what happens here? What's going on? When sound encounters a boundary, one of three things happens. It either bounces off of it, goes through it, or is absorbed by it. And there are materials that absorb sound. You can think about that absorption as existing on a range from nothing, zero, all the way to very absorbing, one on the other end of things. And things that are very reflective, the surface of still water, has an absorption coefficient of around zero. And things that are very absorptive, 4 inches of fiberglass insulation, is very absorptive, 9.9, 0.95, 0.99 in terms of its absorption coefficient. Now, absorption exists differently at different frequencies, and we can take a sort of mid-frequency average. That's called NRC, noise reduction coefficient, if you're familiar with that, sort of an average absorption coefficient. And that's this formula, mid-frequency average. And there is a whole universe of this stuff out there. Now, one of the problems with the acoustics industry is that there's a lot of pixie dust out there as well. But there are some good products in this room. In all cases, when we're absorbing sound, we're taking that sound energy and converting it into heat, right? We are following laws of thermodynamics. And paint is not absorptive. There is no such thing as absorptive paint. There will never be any such thing as absorptive paint. In fact, if you learn only one thing from this whole hour, I hope that you will remember there is no such thing as absorptive paint. Darn is right. There are a couple examples in this room. We have conventional fiberglass-wrapped wall panels right here, fiberglass-wrapped in fabric. Lots of manufacturers make that. And then up on the ceiling, those are Tectum panels up there, painted black. And there's a huge universe of this stuff out there. So very in vogue right now are felt panels and conventional acoustical ceiling tile products. There are this one's USG, this one's Armstrong. There's, you know, manufacturers, Rockfon, others that make conventional ACT. There's also kind of high-end, super high-finish panels. This is a Canadian company called Sky Acoustics that has a very high-end, very smooth finish ACT type product. There's spray applied products that exist in highly nubby or somewhat less nubby in terms of their visual appearance, or sort of really smooth, really, really high-end, like plaster-like surfaces that can span long distances so this is just a sample showing the application process, sort of three-step process that results in a very smooth, very plaster-like surface, but it's, you know, $40 a square foot. So there's a huge range of products out there, and particularly perhaps for the interior designers in the room, if you're interested in exploring some of these, I'm not a product rep. I don't sell any of this stuff. I don't have any financial incentive to any of them, but happy to hang out with some interior designers and talk about different product examples if you're interested in that. Other samples. Quickly wrapping up, we've got, about 2 minutes left or one? Just a few words about performance spaces and auditoriums. Sight lines are very important. If you can't hear, you can't see. Sometimes we want to vary the acoustics in the room by adjusting how absorptive they are, and so we can do that by moving absorption in and out and things like that. We want to control reverberation in performance spaces in different ways, and upholstered seats can sometimes be a key part of that to kind of balance the acoustical condition between rehearsal and performance conditions. And the acoustics of the stage for the performers themselves is a critical component, generally hard surfaces up front. And then at the back of the room, to avoid echoes, generally soft or diffusive surfaces so that the back of the room doesn't create an echo on stage for the people performing. So some really quick rough outlines for performance-based acoustics and what I talked about earlier about the importance of diffusion in spaces. And then, if I may, I'm going to skip ahead and just briefly touch on a topic of interest which may be for some of you, which is computer models. So it is possible to create a three-dimensional model of how a room sounds. And you have a real space and a model of that space, and we can look at all sorts of fancy parameters. But the other thing we can do is not only take that model, but actually listen to it. So you can take a room that hasn't been built yet and go into a room that's specifically designed for reproducing, simulating what that room will sound like before it's built, and comparing with and without absorption, or the ceiling at 30 feet versus the ceiling at 40 feet, which might have a huge financial implication on the project, but also a big acoustical implication. And that kind of simulation can result in some really interesting design decisions that you can actually listen to, and that technology is available now and is very sophisticated and super cool. I will stop there and want to thank you all and hope you enjoyed this talk. Thanks again to Chapman for hosting us.